Barbershop Podcast episode number. I'm going to hit number 228, Ryan Cannon. How close am I? Am
not
I close?
Close.
I am 25. Not even close. Are you kidding me? 225?
That's what Gary said.
I don't trust Gary. Gary is fake news.
Oh.
Okay? Gary is fake news. 225? I will be redeemed on this one. Somewhat closer to 228. Definitely not 225. Somewhere in the ethos of the high 220s.
Good enough for me.
This is the number. Tonight, Wednesday night, as usual, Barbershop Podcast, streaming live from Boxo Studio, in the shadow of the Great Hamilton Mountain, and of course, this musical of all musical cities, Hamilton, Ontario, the blast furnace of original music. We draw from such talent in what we call the Golden Horseshoe. It is horseshoe-shaped, and we are... Certainly we were the fortunate, the wealthy, the Tony with an I, Ontarians, great metropolitan, vibrant, great place to live, Ontario, you gotta like it, gotta love Hamilton, gotta love Barbershop Podcast. You can check it out every Wednesday on Twitch TV, or you can check us out on YouTube or iTunes, Stitcher Radio. Google it on the interweb. And of course, as always, Ryan Cannon is pulling the levers. Gary Greenland is pushing the buttons.
Yeah.
Lots of cool stuff going on back there in control room. Things are under control in the control room.
No. I'm high on dentist drugs again.
Yeah.
It's been a while.
Every Wednesday you get drilled.
I don't know. My dentist is only open on Wednesdays, apparently. But yeah, another root canal today.
Well, it does. It cuts the beer. Purchase price in half because you're half lit when you get here.
Cheap drunk.
Anyway. Music. All kinds of music. We have it here. Obviously, if you've been a fan of Barbershop Podcast, you know from A to Z, we cover it. And we've had artists from all sorts of different countries, but mostly Canada, mostly Ontario, and mostly from around here. And we are fortunate that the medium afforded us, which is the internet, allows us to take what is something that is universal, that's coming from a very regional perspective, and then giving it back on a universal platform. It is fascinating. It is an incredible time to be alive. And tonight's guest is great for a number of reasons. Legitimate musical entity, and by that I mean somebody who was signed, who toured, who did things, who rode in the limousines, who had the great stuff in the green room, the multi-page contracts, the many, many lawyers, and wrote a lot of great tunes, played in a lot of great bands with a lot of great people, and he was one of the first who rode the wave of the popularity of videos killing the radio star, but bringing the good looking and the ably talented further ahead in this world. And if there's anyone who's good looking and ably talented, it's tonight's guest, Thomas Wade. I am so pleased to have you in the studio tonight. How you doing, beautiful?
Wow, I don't know what I say after that. Yes, we killed the radio star, and I felt bad afterwards.
Somewhat.
Just a little bit.
A little bit.
But I regret it now.
Yeah, it's time, Father
I'm
Time catches
for
us.
It now.
No, you look great. You absolutely look great. And I guess there's always been that expectation when you were born into a medium where people have seen what you look like when you're in your 20s. You know, that's what they're going to expect to see all the way.
Yeah, you know what? That was the weirdest thing ever. I couldn't have saw that coming because I started out, I started working on my career way before that. And actually, I got into the video thing way later than people would think. Like, I looked like I was still in my 20s on purpose. But I'd been trying to make it happen since about 10 years before. I was in Nashville in 84 trying to do the thing. And, you know, so...
And that's for a songwriter. So I'm assuming the writing came first, or the playing came first, or they came at the same time when you...
They kind of came at the same time, but when I started out, I played... I'm from Burford, Ontario. That's where I'm from. And we had a little band called Silver Wings. And I started writing music when I was really young, but it never... I sort of never separated them at all. They were always the same thing. And maybe part of that was that I was a huge Beatles fan. So there wasn't, you know, there wasn't that sort of separation that said, you're going to be a writer or you're going to be a singer. To me, it was always going to be the one thing. It was always going to be everything. Yeah. So, so I don't know. I started writing songs when I was about 7, but I started playing guitar and playing live when I was, you know, like 4 and 5. Yeah. So, I know.
Musical family, or was it,
Yeah, musical family. My grandfather had the most popular band in the area. It was called Melody Ranch, and totally musical family. My uncle was a champion fiddle player, and he put me in my first band, so I've been playing live like my entire life, really.
Yeah, and quite often when someone has had a long time in music and is still active and doing okay in music, there's often a lesson that was learned early, you know, that's proven to be very resourceful to you. Is there something that stuck out, or is it just something that seems as natural as, you know, as anything to you? Because it can be a grind. It's a tough business.
Yeah.
But to do it with conviction and be productive for a long period of time, what is it with you?
I've ever since I was a little kid, I've always been the kind of person that I lock on to an aphorism or to a truth. I just eat that up. I was like that when I was a little kid. Yeah. The story of Icarus, you know, was like, I'm a little kid and I'm reading about Icarus, and it takes a bigger man to walk away. You know, I just said that in public school and I got pummeled for it.
By a bigger man. Yeah,
yeah, it's true. By a whole bunch of big... so that's always been a part of who I am. With music, I've always believed, I was raised to believe, the show must go on.
Yeah.
And for me, anybody says, if you're sick or something, oh, I see you're not going to play. What?
Yeah.
I have to be almost dead to not play. It's been like that my entire life. But I think the main thing is, it doesn't matter if there's 10 people out there or if there's, 10,000. You always give it all. You give them the same show.
Yeah.
That's kind of been the way I've always operated.
Do you fall into that persona, like immediately as soon as you strum and play, you're immediately there? Or is it sometimes difficult for you to draw that out?
The microphone's got a lot to do with it. Like when I'm in front of the mic, it changes me.
Yeah.
I find it harder to sing without a mic. And I guess that's just because I've been doing it since I was a little kid, you know. So having that thing, boom, it's like, oh yeah.
It's a cape.
And I'm on. Yeah. It's my cape of invincibility.
Yeah, it's true. I like it. All right. You've got so many tunes, and we're going to talk about your music, what you're doing now. We're going to talk about some of the stuff you did in the early days. But let's get to some music. We start with live tunes. What's the first live tune you're going to do for us today?
Well, I feel like being really just doing what I want to do. And this song has kind of become a bit of a theme song for me, and there's story behind why it's a theme song, but it's a Willie Nelson tune, Funny How Time Slips Away, and I just love it, and I usually start my shows with that.
Okay. You know what, when you start a show, it puts you in the mood, it puts them in the mood, you know it's going to be a winner, and you're going to hear it right here, right now, on barbershoppodcast.com.
hello there. Well, it's been a long, long time. How am I doing? Well, I guess that I'm doing fine. Well, it's been such a long time, but it seems like yesterday. Whoa, ain't it funny how time slips away? How's your new love? Well, I hope that he's doing fine. Did you tell him that you'd love him to the end of time? 'Cause that's the same thing that you told me. Seems like only yesterday. Oh, ain't it funny how time slips away? I'll see you around. I don't know when though, 'cause you never know when I'll be back in town. But just remember what I told you. Oh, someday you're gonna pay. Oh, and it's amazing how time slips away. How time slips away. Time slips away.
Good stuff. That is Thomas Wade, and he is tonight's guest on Barbershop Podcast. Gotta love it. If you love this show, share it, like it, support it. It is entirely our pleasure to do it, and all we do, all we ask is that you, if you love it, is to let other people know about it. That's how things grow. That's how we ingratiate ourselves to other people. Say, hey, I got this great restaurant you got to check out. And when you know you're right, you know you're right. Want to talk about our good friends, the mighty Gladstone Tavern. This is a Hamilton institution. There were times when there was, so many bars in Hamilton and Toronto where you could get a 7-ounce glass of draft and a chunky, a friendly woman would bring it to you at your table, and she would have a bus driver's change on her hip, and they had pool tables, and they had a kitchen, and they featured live music. The owners were always smart enough to know that you bring live music in here, you're going to have a constant, interesting turnover of crowd and individuals. And you know what? Gladstone Tavern is one of those places. They're a sponsor of Barbershop Podcast, helping put music in there because it's wonderful to have as many locations to feature music. The East End of Hamilton has been a hotbed for music so many years with places like the Jockey Club and the Derby that aren't here anymore. But the Gladstone is. It's at the corner of Main Street and Kenilworth in Hamilton, Ontario. They are open pretty sure 6 days a week. Might be open on Sunday. You know, I bet you they are. And they have daily specials. And Thursdays, for example, it's our friends Tyson in there with the band on their open jam night. 450 tall boys, $5 pounds of wings. You just can't get deals like that anymore. Live music. Friday, Saturday, Saturday matinees as well. Comedy nights on Tuesdays. Check them out. Gladstone Tavern. Tell them Kev sent you. All right, business being done. Now we move on to the business of independent music and kind of making your own way. So talk about the early days. Things were different then, but they're kind of the same too, right? Were you, tell me about your first thing that you put out that had your name on it, and tell me about the first kind of outfit that started getting traction for you.
Well, I think the first outfit that I ever had that really started getting any real inroads, I guess. I mean, you know, there's regional, there's local, and that sort of thing. Would have to be the Thomas Wade and Wayward, which is the band that I had the most success with. And interestingly enough, the original lineup of that band, we played the Gladstone with that band in 1984.
Classic.
We did. So I know what you're talking about.
Yeah.
I met her, you know.
Yeah.
And you didn't just buy one draft. What's wrong with you, man? You get a tray. Like,
They're tiny.
Right? Yeah. They bring a tray. Yeah. These little glasses. They're like the glasses my old man used to drink from. Yeah. Like. Yeah. You know, he gets the glass and he puts the salt in the beer.
Because I'm assuming a lot of these guys in the bands were from the region and the area that you grew up with. And there's a country sensibility, but that all that great swamper rock and that southern rock must have been a big influence. And there was all sorts of other sounds that were kind of very of that era. It was a very good time for music.
Oh, yeah. I was really, I had very, very broad influences. Like when I started out, I started country as country could be, you know, sitting around the table with my mom and my dad and doing, you know, anything from Patsy Cline to, you know, we did some, you know, K-Star as well. Like my mom was beautiful voice, still is beautiful voice, sang that kind of uptown thing. With Loretta Lynn, and you know, and then there was a, you know, Johnny Cash was my hero, and so, but then I got a little bit older, and I got in the Beatles. The Beatles were like, I'm born again.
Yeah, we hear that. So younger guys maybe Kiss, but Beatles for 70% of the time, like that changed people's lives.
It did. When I put Abbey Road on, like when I went out and bought it, and. You know, that for my family, that was like a heresy.
Yeah, like Jack Pedler said, his dad, the musician was just like, "What the hell is this garbage?"
Yeah, that was heresy for me.
Yeah,
like the as rocky as we were allowed to be was Elvis, which it's fine with me. I love Elvis, but Beatles were like, what?
Yeah.
You know, but then I went on from there, and I really got into R&B. I was very, very influenced by Peebo Bryson and James Ingram and people like that, and they had a lot to do with the singer I became. So by the time we got to gigging in the '80s was a perfect time to be that guy, because you had like Lee Greenwood. You get guys that could sing, and they had the soul, you know, like Ronnie Millsap.
Yep. And the new country is coming out. The Dwight Yoakam and the Travis Tritt and eyes were opening.
It was a rich time.
Yeah.
Musically, so it was a perfect time for me to start getting some footing, and you know, but then it was 95, 96 when the Thomas Wade and Wayward record came out, and we had a huge following in Ontario and even across the country by then. So we put this record out, and it was sort of anticipated. But it's the video that really did it.
Yeah.
You know, the video, did the thing.
Right? What was the budget on the video back then?
Well, this was the most we ever spent on a video. I think we spent like $25,000.
Yeah.
And it was at... Lulu's Roadhouse.
Yeah, in Kitchener.
So it was the big, you know, you're already famous video, yeah, right? Yeah. That one, kind of like Mr. Achy Breaky Heart guy, right?
Yeah.
That's the deal, right? You get the people, you get the big crowd, and, oh, they must be famous already. Yeah. You know, so our first single, you know, went 15, number 15. And for an unsigned band, that was pretty remarkable.
Yeah, sweet. All right, we're going to take a look at it. That era, that video, 0 to 60. And is there anything that people are going to want to know about this video? Cute things that happened but they can keep an eye out for?
Well, 0 to 60 was our first top 10. It was actually our second single. And again, top 10 for a independent band was kind of ridiculous. But this video, we just got lucky. It was dirt cheap. It was like $8,000.
Yeah.
And Terrence Odette was the director on that, who lives right here in Hamilton, and him and Arthur Cooper, just great cinematography. It was a beautiful shoot, very minimal, but all about performance.
Cool. Well, you're gonna get to go back in time, in the present day, right here, right now, on BarbershopPodcast.com.
Young and wild, first time at the wheel. It's like he was born to make tires squeal. Pull on the highway, pull out the fast. The inside lane and slammed on the gas. 0 to 60 in the blink of an eye. It was all just a blur as he blew on by. On a white knuckle dead run, you just had to see how fast he could get. From 0 to 60. White lines, a life got lost in mile marker signs. But he was going places, never crossed his mind. What jet in the head was leaving behind. 0 to 60 in the blink of an eye. It was all just a blur as he blew on by. On a white knuckle dead run, he just had to see how fast he could get. Big line of cars, but he's still in the lead. Oh, there's friends and family he never knew well, and dozens of roses he'll never smell. And if he could sit up, he'd see it all now. Life will pass you by if you don't slow down.
0 to 60 in the blink of an eye. All just a blur as he blew on by. On a white knuckle dead run, you just had to see how fast he could get. From 0 to 60.
Thomas Wade and the Waywards. That is a kick-ass song, and we were saying that was new country before new country was new country. And that is still, it's like looking at a car that's a nice design 20 years later, it still looks current. That doesn't, other than you're incredibly young and with tons of hair and like,
baby boy.
My goodness, it's great to have that stuff documented forever, right?
No, it really is. Yeah. It that was really good for me to have that hanging around. And I mean, it's funny how everything changed, you know, and it, like, well, CMT, does it exist? I don't even know if it exists.
You know what? I think it does, but I think like a lot of things, it doesn't exist in that format anymore.
Right.
But that were truly, there were people with talent who could do something creative that got seen, and it was a great, it was kind of like the internet before its time, where it superseded the traditional kind of wall that you had to get through to get to mainstream, to get radio, to get played, right?
Yeah.
What were some of the things that you learned? I mean, over the years, you must have learned a lot of tricks of the trade and sort of being in the business. Is there any truism? I mean, I'm thinking about, I get a lot of really talented, dedicated, committed young people, and I wonder how many are going to be dedicated, talented old people in this business, because so many just stop after a while because they have a family to support or they have something to do other than music to support themselves because it's tough. And to be able to find success early and still be able to be in the business as you have, there must have been, you probably right off the bat, you were doing a lot of your own research and doing your own marketing and doing a lot of things that take for granted.
Well, it was a different time. I mean, I'm going through this stuff right now. Back in the day, people used to hire you. I mean, if you were good, people wanted you, and they'd go look for you, and they'd pay for you.
Yeah.
And it's a different time, you know. You know, and back in the day, I'd make a video, and it would go on CMT, and everybody would see it.
Yeah.
And then I would...
Your tour would be
booked.
Everybody
wanted to... Yeah, it's like... Couldn't get enough of me, and you know, couldn't get enough of us. We were inundated. So, you know, mostly what I had to learn is I had to learn how to maintain the freshness of the product. And that, what that means is that you have to maintain what it was that brought you to music. And I really tried to be like, I really only had two CDs that I did before I had a sort of a cataclysmic event that took me out of music. But every time I made a record, I did what I wanted to do.
Yeah.
And I know. Now, the first time I did what I wanted to do, it's the reason that anything happened.
Yeah.
Because if we'd done what everybody else did, it wouldn't have mattered. But it was like, it's always been this. This might be it, man.
Yeah.
This might be it. So every time you go in, you got to think, this might be it. And if you're not listening with your own ears, and if you're not writing with your own gut, then you're blowing it.
Yeah.
Because you got to be happy to fail with it.
And perspective is an amazing thing. It's thrust upon us so often when we don't expect it,
Nobody knows what's going to happen.
Yeah.
I mean, 1997, we were on the CCMA. We actually had the most nominations of anyone at the CCMAs in 1997. And we were on the show. At that time, I had the very beginnings of having some real trouble with my voice. And my voice was so bad at soundcheck that the director said, okay, well, you guys are gonna have to lip sync. And I said, no way, man. And I was not a business guy. I wasn't the kind of guy who was gonna stand up to a dude with a suit.
Yeah.
Except when you put me against a wall, then I was like, no way, man. And that's what I said. I said, no way. So I went upstairs and I worked my hole off until I had a voice. And you wouldn't know it. It's on YouTube now. You wouldn't know there was anything wrong with me. But that's just because I said to myself, what if this is it?
Yeah.
And it was.
Yeah. And it truly was. If the one thing that makes you great is taken away from you, and of all the things they could take away from you, why your voice? And in such a manner, were you classically trained, like with voice lessons, or
no? But yeah, I had a very natural voice, and I was able to do a lot of different things with it. And I'm pretty sure, you know, when I say about maintaining the freshness of the product, what really happened was that I got so involved with the pressure of the business that even though I made records I wanted to make, I stopped loving it. And I didn't know I'd stop loving it. You know, it's like at one point I was a boxer, but at some point I turned into a brawler. So I went from the sweet science to being a brawler.
Yeah.
And then I got knocked on my ass.
Yeah.
And that's what happened. You know?
A wonderful analogy. I love the wordsmith. I love the way the turn of phrase happens in the creative mind of the artist. We're going to talk about that life-changing experience, but we're going to have another live tune from you now. What are you going to play for us next?
I'd like to do a song that that I wrote with my good friend Tim Taylor in Nashville. He's the guy I went to when I knew I was going to make this record. Because this was another, you know, this might be it. So this has to be the record I want to make. And he was the only guy that, I don't know, that I felt had the same sensibility as I did. And the first song we wrote, I didn't even know I was making a record yet. And we wrote this song down there. And it just says great American songbook. Now he's going to sing.
Well, he's got something to prove. He's going to prove it to all of us. And I love this man. And you're going to hear it right here, right now, barbershoppodcast.com.
All the books on the shelf she was meaning to read, and the hook on the door where her robe used to be, and the frilly white curtains I never did like. Funny, what makes you cry? A single red rose by her side of the bed, faded and withered and hanging its head in this lonely room where love lived and died. Funny, what
makes you cry. I watched from the door as she walked away, stood there like a stone with nothing to say. You know, we never even said goodbye. I just turned around and walked inside. As the day slips away and the night starts to fall, that live, love, and laugh that she hung on the wall disappears in the shadows, like the love in her eyes. Funny, what makes you cry? I watched from the door as she walked away, stood there like a stone with nothing to say. And no, we never even said goodbye. Just turned around and walked inside. As the day slips away and the night starts to fall, that live, love, and laugh that she hung on the wall disappears in the shadows, like the love in her eyes. Funny, what makes you cry?
Bit of a torch song. Love, 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 love performance. And that's what you'll get. Go out to your local music venue. There are many, many. There are ones in libraries, and there are ones in civic centers, and there are many in the purveyors of sudsy beer, delicious booze, as Tim Gibbons would say, wherever they are. Go support those musicians and tell the owner or manager that you go there because you like the music. That's why you came there. If you come there, let them know. Keep the business, keep the industry strong, thriving, and alive. All right, going to give you a little shout-out because it's that time of year to Heather and her good friends over at Taxes Done Right. They do our taxes. They do our books. They can do your taxes for an incredible deal, certainly compared to those shysters at the mall. I won't say who they are, but we know who I'm talking about. They charge too much, and they don't dig hard enough, and Taxes Done Right will do that. Your deal is going to be... sizzling, what can I say? Okay, get it done now, get it done right. That is the number, that is the email. Get a hold of them, time's running out. Tick, 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 get them done. All right, we are here with Thomas Wade, and we touched on what was clearly to you at a terrifying event when you lose your voice. Were you in denial for a certain period of time, or you thought it was just something that was going to cure itself or you'd get better? At what point did you, was it after that performance where you had to, and when you said you found a voice, I'm imagining what you're talking about is you had to hit a frequency, a range, you had to get through the performance, and you did not have your regular tools with you. You had to somehow compress, squish your voice, find a different voice that still sounded like your voice, and sing almost in an entirely different way. Is that was what you're kind of going through?
Well, you know, it's very well put, actually. And it actually applies in a much broader sense. when this was going on in 1997, I had experienced a lot of trouble with my voice, but it just sort of came upon me. We were like crazy busy. We were always playing really smoky places. We were playing loud places, and we played constantly. And I was always hitting it hard. But everything started changing slowly. Well, 97, basically I was dealing with throat troubles, and that's all I thought I was dealing with. And I went and I had surgery for polyps, my cords, right after the CCMAs in 1997. But I went on to recover after the surgery and to write more and record more. And then, but just gradually, things started changing again. I thought I was out of the woods, and I wasn't out of the woods. And then 2001, December of 2001, I had a brand new record that was doing pretty well. And I'd had some new singles that were doing pretty well. And I was in Yorkton, Saskatchewan, and I was the headliner, and I went out, tried to sing. And this horrible sound came out. And it was nothing I'd ever experienced in my life. And I couldn't shake it the entire night. And I ended up going home and going to specialists. And nobody could figure out what it was. And I had to retire from singing in 2002. The last big show I did, theater concert,
and not just for you, but the guys in the band. Like, you must have felt like all this weight on your shoulders. That like,
oh yeah. Not only that, I mean, I had a young son.
Yeah.
Had my my girlfriend, who's now my wife, and it was like, yeah, I got to be this, and some of it was that. It was that I got to be this. Then by 2004. I was a producer and I was a writer. I ended up having a Celine Dion cut, and you know, like I put the gas on as a writer, and that worked out. And then I stopped being able to speak. I started not being able to pronounce words, form words. I sounded kind of like I'd had a stroke. By 2006, I was diagnosed with oromandibular dystonia, which was incurable. So I spent a good 10 years not being able to sing or to speak, less time with the speaking, about 7 years, but nonetheless, you know, a week not being able to speak will freak you out. And so, you know, being able to do what I'm doing now is one of the main reasons that I really understand the whole concept of the love. Don't lose the love. Because you don't know what's going to happen, and as soon as you stop valuing this thing that is far more important than getting paid, and you know, I'm still doing it, and you and I have talked about this about the people that you get success when you're young, you start getting paid when you're really young, and here you are. You know, I'm going to be 56 this year, and I'm still doing this. Well, I went through a long time where I paid a little bit, then I went through a little tiny period when I made a lot, and then I went through a long period where I didn't make anything. So, and what does it end up being about? You can't forget to love it.
Yeah.
So this thing you said about the voice, you know, I went through a great big period of time when I was using a voice that wasn't even my voice, just so I could get by. And what you hear now, this is what I sound like.
Yeah, this is you.
And this is what I sounded like before that, too. So it's kind of like, wonderful. You know, homecoming.
Yeah, and this is at the core. This is what we preach here, you know, every week. This is... There's an intangible, right? There's something in music where it's zeros and ones, you know, but it's so much more. How does it make it? Why does the hair stand up on this song? Why does this one make me think of this? And it's because of what's inside. and the beauty that the, you can't quantify that that X factor. We're going to play a cut off of this this beautiful CD, Blue Country Soul. Very nice picture and way to describe it. Blue Country Soul, you're kind of obviously trying to give an indication of the flavor when someone looks at this as a complete neophyte, what it is, what it sounds like. And I think you hit it on the head, didn't you?
I'm trying to say this is who I am.
Yeah.
Because this might be it. That's why I'm doing it.
Beautiful. Well, I love a nice piece of production, as you do, I'm sure, and going into the studio and rubbing your hands together and putting the syrup on is a beautiful thing, right?
Happy
when
place.
You got a stack of hot flapjacks, it's time to make music. Beautiful. All right, this one's called She's Already Gone. Anything we should know about it?
This is another one written with my good friend Tim Taylor. And I always like this idea just because I like songs that come out of what people say. I like songs that come out of real stuff. And I remember I was talking to some young fella, and I'm constantly amazed at how little young fellows seem to know about women.
About the ladies.
And it's like, maybe I'm a lot older. Maybe I've always been a lot older than I than I am. But this guy was talking, about something. And I said, man, if she's talking about leaving, she's already gone.
Brilliant.
Because that's the way they are, man.
That's the way it is. Love the way that sounds. You're going to love the way this sounds right here on barbershoppodcast.com.
You think you've got it made now that you've got her. Brother, I felt the same until I lost her. You think she's beautiful now? You ought to see her in my memories, how we used to be. You got her on your arm like she's some kind of trophy. You show her all around town for your cool fool friends to see. You gotta dig a little deeper if you wanna keep her. Cause if she's talking to you, you better listen, or you won't have a clue what you'll be missing when she's walking away and you can't even say what went wrong. Cause if she's talking about leaving, brother, she's already gone. Listen to her plans and dreams, listen to her hopes and fears. And if she cries at night, be sure to catch every tear. Little things you think don't mean nothing, it sure means something to her. Every single word. You think it's all about all the kissing and hugging, but if you don't learn, there's a whole lot more to loving. She could be long gone down the road, and you don't even know. Cause if she's talking to you, you better listen, or you won't have a clue what she'll be missing when she's walking away, and you can't even say what went wrong. Cause if she's talking about leaving, brother, she's already gone. She's walking away.
already gone.
She's Already Gone by Thomas Wade. You can get that on his latest CD, Blue Country Soul. Where can people get a hold of this? Off of your website, no doubt.
Yeah, and it's on iTunes. And, you know, but the best way to get it is to come out and see me play.
It is, because often you get the best of both worlds. You get the live show, which is amazing, right? When you go to a live show, there is actual waves that enter your body that make all the difference in the world. And then you take home something that's like, oh, now I can remember time and time again.
It's special.
It is. We can't have one. Well, you can have one, but we don't recommend it. We always say that you can combine your live and your take home music experience. It's kind of like the doggy bag of the night that you had. But I got some upcoming gigs that you want to let anyone know about.
I have a little thing coming up this this weekend in Maryhill at the Commercial Tavern. It's kind of a mecca of cool music, and I'm going to be playing there with my old friend Jamie Warren, who's, you know, we sort of chased each other up and down the charts for a few years.
Yeah.
And we started out playing in a band together, Warren and Wade, and I know we played here. We played the Jockey Club.
Yeah.
I never forget that load-in.
Classic.
I think I still heard a little bit.
Yeah.
But yeah, and so we're doing that. But the big one for me is I have a show called An Intimate Evening with Thomas Wade at the Lincoln Alexander Theater on April 29th, and for me, it's, you know, I played a little bit. I toured last December as a part of a thing called the Canadian Country Christmas Tour, and, you know, and I played a little bit here and there. But to me, this show is kind of my real homecoming. Yeah. Because the last time I played a big theater show, which was my meat, that was kind of my thing. My thing was soft seat.
Yeah.
Because you can talk to people.
Yeah.
You can tell
they're
them a joke.
Captive audience. They're there for a reason.
They know why they're there. They sit in that seat, and they know. And the last time I did that was in Hamilton. It was 2002. And so that's what this is. And Lincoln Alexander Theater is a beautiful theater.
It's a beautiful theater. Our good friend Paul Anthony got his hands in there.
Yes.
And he is a good man. And exciting things happening for that as a soft seater, something that Hamilton desperately needed. You need a soft seater for the true music fans to go. A night not to be missed, for sure. We're going to have a link to this in the description. And if it's after the fact, you know, there may be a recording or a video or something, you know, just look it up. But I'm sure it's not going to be the last we're going to hear about that place, and certainly about you.
Oh, I hope not, because it is a beautiful theater.
And what's the date on that again for everyone?
April 29th.
April 29th, and then the Lincoln Alexander Center. Get on your Google machine. It'll tell you all you need to know. Okay, you're going to do another live one for us.
Surely.
This is the deal. What is being offered up?
Well, I'm going to do this song. This one is actually my most favorite one of all the songs. And I guess a lot of it is just that when I went through all the stuff that I went through, my wife, Denise, stayed with me for and really, if it weren't for her, I don't know what would have happened to me, because, you know, I was pretty much you know, quite a bit of devastation. And you can't sing, and then you can't talk. And it's like, go get a job at... Oh, hey, you have to be able to talk to work there. Oh. Yeah. So it was pretty heavy, and but she never let me... She never looked at me any different. Mm-hmm. You know, when I met her, I was...
It wasn't about that you were a rock star, was it?
No.
It wasn't that she was the captain's lady.
It was wasn't.
Yes, that she loved you for you, you know.
And everybody kind of thought that, you know, because it was like, you know, when we met, I was that guy. Yeah. But that's not who she is. And you know, they... There's something that Conway Twitty says, or said. Conway Twitty, when asked, how do you pick a song? And he said, what I do is I pick a song that says what every man wants to say to his woman, but he doesn't know how to say it.
I don't think I'm ever going to forget those words.
And that's how he picks a song. And this song... is about that. This song says that. That's what it's for. So,
well, you
it's called
are,
That's What Love Looks Like to Me.
That's What Love Looks Like to Me, and it's what it sounds like. And you're going to be able to hear it and feel it and see it right here, right now on barbershoppodcast.com.
In the mirror, counting all the little lies, the gentle reminders of the passage of time, and you don't think it's the picture of the girl you used to be. Well, baby, that's what love looks like to me. I see you at your dresser table, tracing silver strands of hair. They're all part of your beauty to the man who put them there. Don't you know how much I want you? How can I make you see? That's what love looks like to me. You're beautiful in every way, more beautiful every day. Your love is a work of art. I see with my eyes and my heart. You're beautiful in every way, more beautiful every day. Your love is a work of art. I see with my eyes and my heart. Don't you know how much I want you? How can I make you see, baby? that's what love looks like to me. Baby, that's what love looks like to me.
Well, I'll pay you a huge compliment, because throughout that, all I could think of was the late, great Roy Orbison. Wow. And, a songwriting forte, you know, a tour de force, to be able to take something and kind of majestically sweep it. Get outside of your box, because there must have been a certain conformity about when you did something and done it successfully for a while, that you built songs in tight little structures that worked for you. Did you have to relearn anything musically? Did you just get bored and kind of turn over a new leaf? What's the process of going from, you know, the video sensation, you know, boot scooting, kick ass, to the troubadour now? Like, what's, is it just a maturation process, like natural as rain?
Well, I think that this song and this album is that. I think what it is for me is, I think a lot of people do this. I've watched a documentary about Trio, Dolly Parton, Emmylou Harris, and Linda Ronstadt. And hearing about Linda Ronstadt and where she comes from musically, that she she talked about singing those old songs with that authenticity, and she said that it had to feel like, from, you know, that being in her living room when she was a kid, it had to feel like that. And I got so much great music from my youth. I mean, when I was a little kid, I was singing songs that were 5 or 10 years older than me. So when I came back to this time, when it was like, okay, I get a chance to do this again. First of all, when I redeveloped my voice, when I rebuilt my voice, I went back to my original love. My original love was old, beautiful music, melodic music, very spare but elegant writing. Whereas, you know, in 1993, some of the first stuff I did was went into that clever thing, very briefly though.
Yeah.
Because the one thing that I can say that I can be grateful for about me is I have like a huge influence base, and not just music. I mean, I'm also influenced by literature and poetry.
Yeah.
And that was my thing. My thing is, don't. When somebody tells you there's a formula, man, run the other way. Run fast, run hard.
Yeah.
Because there is no formula. There isn't. There's a craft. And even the craft, once in a while, you got to skip around it. You know, somebody might say, well, you know, you sing a line and you ended it with love, let's say, is the last word. But then you write another line and the end of that word is love too. Sometimes the repetition is worth it. Sometimes it has an effect, but you don't do anything for nothing. That's the craft. So I'm just grateful that I've been fierce about guarding that. I've written a ton of different styles, and I never wanted to sound cheap.
Yeah, and I'm sure there's been many times there's a song that you didn't want to, it was almost done, but you were going to have to shoehorn a chunk in there that just wasn't going to look right. And maybe no one else would notice, but it would bug your ass every day, right?
Right. So then it goes, I don't care how long a song takes. I don't care how long it takes to write it. It doesn't matter. I mean, there's one song on that record I could have said was the one to go for, and it's taken me 10 years to write it. And just because it took me 10 years,
because parts of it were so good early on,
you knew
it's like this thing needed justice.
The idea was that good, and I knew the idea was worth clinging to, and like, you know, like a, you know, like a chihuahua on the mailman's leg, you know. I just was like, I'm not letting go of this, and I'm not cheapening it out. I'm not going to just finish it.
Yeah.
If it takes me 10 years, I don't care.
Yeah.
And sure enough, this record, I was down in Nashville writing, and I didn't even co-write this one. I'd already had so much done on it. Not that I wouldn't have co-written, but it just happened, and I just, lightning struck. And that's the way it works. So, you know, song is, it's kind of like a, you know, with
a. So you don't mind carrying around a chunk of a song for a long period of time?
No.
Okay, good.
I've done it many times.
Yeah.
And, it, you know, it's kind of like a chunk of marble.
Yeah.
A chunk of marble is going to be what it's going to be.
You still don't know what it is.
Yeah, you don't tell what it's going to be because it's got these things in it, right?
Yeah.
Anybody really knows how to work it knows you can't just make it whatever you want it to be. You have to let it be what it wants to be. Right?
Yeah. Beautiful. All right. We're going to check out another one of your videos because you have probably more videos than anyone we've had else on our show, which is kind of great, right? So you're number one in something, and your video has always been good. So lying here with you, what's your story on that one?
Well, one thing about that one is talking about taking your time. The title itself took like 3 months because I wrote it with Cyril Ross in Nashville, and he had the original Lying with the Truth, and I was like, and we went ping pong, took 3 months.
Yeah.
But we wrote the song. People probably would say this is my biggest song, and because it was a number one video, it got compromised at radio, because that was when BDS came out, changed everything, right? So they, all of a sudden, it's not just an open field. Now it's like there's a little club that decides whether or not you get on the charts or not, which is, I'm not even going to say what that is, but it is what it is.
We know what it is.
It's a number one video.
I used to call that racketeering.
Yeah. But this is the one when this piano part, when I was playing concert, this is one of my favorite memories of playing music at all.
Yeah.
Being on a stage and the lights go down and then the piano part starts and then the crowd goes, wah! Yeah. And that's one of my favorite things, just feeling that.
It is beauty. You're going to hear it. Lying here with you on barbershoppodcast.com.
Have this silent conversation every night. The way we lay here barely touching says it all. I'm so far from that old feeling, so close to getting up and leaving. But when I reach for the door, there's just a wall. 'Cause I know you'll say you love me, and I know I'll say you too. But heaven knows I hate this hell that we're going through. I wish that I could bring myself to stand and face the truth. Instead of turning out the light and lying here with you. The shadows of our love still fill this room. With the moonlight shining softly on your skin. But all those memories wash away as a tear rolls down your face.
And I just can't hold you close like I did then. Cause I know you'll say you love me, and I know I'll say me too. But heaven knows I hate this hell that we're going through. I wish that I could bring myself to stand and face the truth. Instead of turning out the light and lying here with you. We're living here together, but you're loving all alone. I can't hold you honestly, and I can't let you go. Cause I know you'll say you love me, and I know I'll say me too. But heaven knows I hate this hell that we're going through. I wish that I could bring myself to stand and face the truth. Instead of turning out the light and lying here with you. Truth is I can't stand myself. Here with you.
Man, you were emo before emo was emo, weren't you? That was like that. No, but it's actually to put the feel in something. People don't understand that when they look at these early videos, like there was such earnesty in everything. It was before there was this kind of this cynical layer, you know, and sure there was that, yeah, you know, and you know, the song factories and all of that big business, but kind of coming out of the era of the singer songwriter. And I remember because I was in journalism and video was busted, right? No one wanted to work in radio. We all wanted to work in TV. You know, right. it was a new thing. And there really wasn't any forethought about a master plan on how to do these things. It was kind of laid out, and it was definitely a storyboard you had to tell. A story, and now I don't necessarily know if that's the case. People look back, and some of them may have a long face, but when I look back at videos done in certain eras, it's the same as listening to music in certain areas. Mm-hmm. They have the, you know, you can listen to it and go, I can tell by the gait on the drums within 2 years mm-hmm. when that was recorded.
Totally.
And I could,
you totally. Know. Totally. Yeah. I mean, there is something about... like for instance that video there, having things happen from the inside out is really important to me, and that may be a hard thing to understand for some people, but basically I went to acting school. I trained as an actor to become a video to do my videos and actually to get so I could to speak on stage so I could be the MC, because when I got into the band I wasn't ever the guy that talked.
Right.
So, and that took me down another road, and that other road was being honest. Not just when you're singing, because when you're singing it's got to be that way too. When you hit that chewy center when you're singing, like when you hit that spot where you almost push yourself over the tears, you know what I'm saying?
Oh, I totally.
When you hit that spot, then you know you're doing it right. Like if you got to go,
yeah,
then you know that you've hit it, and that's my favorite thing.
Yeah,
it's hard because you don't know, right?
Oh, I so get it.
But with that video, that was very much the deal. And Terry Odette did that one as well. And that was a very big video. And, but he, I think he understood too that I really wanted to, I wanted to be real. I wanted my process to do what it did in the song. When I sang the song, it was like, I want to go to this real place. And I think that there's a thing where things have gotten a lot dancier. Like a lot, I watch television, I watch, and I see the acting. Some of it's great, but some of it, there's a dancey thing to it. You know, you do this, so I'm gonna do this, and I'm gonna make this face, I'm gonna clench my jaw. And I don't like that. I like raw and real, and sometimes it's awesome, sometimes you screw it up, but it doesn't matter.
Yeah, we are great proponents of real here. So we say about Barbershop Podcast, real Hamilton, real people, real music, real good. Get real. It's like, that is exactly what we talk about. Don't try to pretend to be anything you're not, and you will never regret it a day in your life. You'll be surrounded by the people who truly dig you for you and what you do, and will support you in the times when you're going to need it, and the amount of fair weather friends are reduced exponentially.
Yes.
You know, and you don't need that. We know what I need. I need more live music. I need
more live music.
You're gonna do one more
more live music.
Yeah, you're gonna do one more tune live for us. What are you gonna cook up for us in the mind of Thomas Wade?
You know what I feel like doing, and this is like, of course, off script because I don't have one. Do you guys have a capo?
Yes, it's just a matter of digging. You know, see if there's one if Gary can find one in the room back there. Oh, I think there might be even one attached to the stereo cabinet upstairs. I can't leave because I'm a guest. That's why we need interns. If you are an intern who wants to run around the studio.
How are we doing? Did I?
No. We can do this. This is what makes it spontaneous. Because I had like four. You know, you get a Kaiser in every color, right?
Yeah.
You get a black one, a silver one, and a goldy one. And I had three, and then I had two, and then I had one, and then I had none. And then the gold one showed up. So I have one again. And it was like, and I remember where it was. It was like on a very strange spot that's guaranteed not to be there anymore because it was there.
Well, that's that thing, right? It's like, and whenever you play a gig, you are guaranteed to lose a capo. So
look at that, Goldie.
Well, there it is.
Goldie Kaiser.
He's got the Goldie. He's got that Goldie.
Comes to the rescue.
Here comes that Goldie.
And capo songs are great too because they kind of open up a whole new. You know, you put a capo on, it changes. You're playing something familiar, but you're playing it in a whole new key. And it just changes right in front of you.
When I was a kid, they used to call them cheaters.
Cheaters, yeah. Because you should be able to transpose to every single.
But I'm telling you, this song that I'm going to play is the song that was recorded by Celine Dion in 2004. And this song, the guitar part, I mean, I'm not doing it the way it was originally done. Because what happened was I was in Nashville and I was doing a lot of writing. And I'm playing in drop D right now. And I was really doing all these cool. Right? All these weird inversions, but I was doing it all the time. And I woke up one morning after doing a ton of writing, and I had this panic that I don't want to repeat myself. I don't want to start being formulaic. So I started tuning my guitar so I couldn't play it. I just kept tuning it, and till I could play it, it played something open, but I didn't know how to play it. And then I started messing around. And it sounded kind of like this. And then I could hear. I could hear this thing. Baby, come to me. Come to me. jeez. Ah, goosebumps. And kept working on it, and I was writing with Beverly Mahood in Nashville. And she put it on her demo that she was working on, and she went to her friend David Foster, and David Foster said, yeah, you're not recording that song.
I could have kicked
and
that upstairs.
It went to Celine Dion. And the other thing that's really important to me about this song, and can I just say I'm really grateful to be on this show, because I like talking to you about music. You know, there's a lot of people that are just sitting there waiting for the next thing to happen, but we're communicating, and I like it.
I like it too, thank you.
The first line to this song was the most important thing to me. And I think it's cool that it's really the biggest, it's the most successful thing I ever did. Obviously, it's Celine Dion recorded it, so, yeah. You know, I made a few bucks on it. I needed a first line. The first line's the most important thing. And I thought to myself, what would be the one thing that everybody would need to hear? And so I wrote this first line so that every time somebody heard it, they could feel like it was being said to them. And the song's actually written about my son, or to my son, who was 5 at the time. The only song I've written for my son. I'm not one of those, I have a kid, I better write a song, guys. Yeah. Here we go.
I will always love you, no matter what, no matter where you go or what you do, and knowing you, you're gonna have to do things your own way, but that's okay, you're free, spread your wings. But promise me one thing, if you ever need a place to cry, baby, come to me, come to me. I've always known that you were born to fly, but you can come to me if the world breaks your heart, no matter where on earth you are. You can come to me. Walk around with the world on your shoulders and your highest hopes laying on the ground. I know you think you've got to try to be my hero, but don't you know the stars you wish upon may fall, it's true. But I still believe in you. If you ever need a place to cry, baby, come to me. Come to me. I've always known that you were born to fly, but you can come to me if the world breaks your heart, no matter where on earth you are. You can come to and those 7 seas you say.
lost and feeling all alone. Let my heart be your beacon home. If you ever need a place to cry, baby, come to me. Come to me. I've always known that you were born to fly, but you can come to me. If the world breaks your heart, no matter where on earth you are, you can come to me.
Heartfelt. What could be better, you know, in a world of cloying and couched approximations? Nothing is better than something that is straight up and straight from the heart. And I thank you for bringing that in here tonight, along with so much other great music. It is a testament to a life dedicated to music. You haven't trifled and you haven't screwed around, and we appreciate it. Thanks so much for coming in. You know, I'm sure we'll be seeing you again. It's one of those things. Get this CD. It is Kick 'Em Ass'em. Come check out the show. Follow the links. For Ryan Cannon, Gary Greenland, I'm your host, Kevin Barber. Thanks so much, Thomas.
Thank you so much. It's been a great pleasure.
All around. See everyone next week on Barbershop Podcast.